Good afternoon. First, a new detail surrounding the tragic death of a young rugby league player in Spain. Liam Hampson was a Queensland Redcliffe Dolphins player. His body found in a Barcelona nightclub 2 days after his friends reported him missing while on holidays. The 24-year-old's death has rattled family, friends, teammates, even members of the Australian NRL team competing at the World Cup. So many people desperate for answers. What we do know is that local police are trying to work out if Liam may have suffered some sort of fall. Our reporter will have more coming up in 30 minutes. The failures of Australia's response to the COVID-19 pandemic have been laid bare in a new independent review. As Eddie Meyer reports, it reveals disadvantaged and vulnerable people bore the brunt of our mistakes.
It's a forensic look at how Australia dealt with the health and financial crisis COVID-19 wrought on our country. The independent review comes to blunt conclusions. Economic support should have been more equitably spread because it left the disadvantaged and vulnerable to bear the brunt. And schools should have stayed open in most cases. The harshest criticism was for lockdowns and border closures, concluding that while they worked at the beginning, they were used too excessively.
A lockdown is a sledgehammer. That should have been used to buy you the time to get all of those other bits and pieces into place so that you don't need a lockdown.
Even now, we got certain things wrong, and that's our lessons for the future.
So, what are those lessons? I'll have a full report, 9 News at 6.
Former NRL player Jamil Hopoate has been sentenced to 3 years and 9 months jail for his role in a major drug ring. The former Brisbane Broncos player was arrested as part of a police sting in May and convicted of transporting cocaine across Sydney. Well, people across the Murray region are coming together to save their communities from ruin as rising floodwaters threaten to destroy hundreds of homes. Hayley Francis reports from Moama.
Well, we're out here on the Murray River today with Foxtrot 1, made up of SES volunteers, fire and rescue and surf life saving. They're out here surveying these border towns, which are starting to really feel the impact of this flood as the threat only creeps closer. The community here on the banks, both in New South Wales and Victoria, have not stopped. They continue to build these sandbag levee banks, hope to hold back this rising water from entering hundreds of homes.
You don't really get enough time to think about it. You just sort of go, go, go.
We had a bit of a late start, but we're getting there. So the manpower is just awesome.
A bit worn out, but just got to keep going. What else do we do?
Emergency services have not stopped either, assisting with evacuations, patrolling the river, and today even saving local wildlife. While we were on board, this distressed wallaby spotted swimming in the swollen Murray River. The little guy carefully brought to dry land where he finally found his feet. The Bureau of Meteorology has warned of heavy rain on the way for large parts of New South Wales, and it will amplify the flood threat here on the border, which is why right now it's all about building up as much protection as possible. The Murray River here is expected to continue rising as it's fed more and more water from the Goulburn River. The community here now prepared, they're ready, but they've got a slow wait ahead.
And as Melbourne flood victims return to their homes, devastated Maribyrnong residents say scammers have tried to sign up for recovery grants, stealing their money for themselves. Maggie Rayworth has the story.
If flood victims didn't already have enough on their plate, now some are claiming they're being targeted by cruel scammers. Stan Gradsky lives on Oakland Street. That's one of Maribyrnong's hardest hit suburbs. He lives with his 92-year-old mother, and his home was destroyed by floodwater on Friday. He says scammers are using his details to claim government grants designed to support flood victims. Today, a very upset Stan says he was knocked back when he tried to apply for the financial help, told it had already been claimed multiple times from people residing at his address.
They said there's all these other different names, you know, and I says, no, they don't live here. But somebody must have got on and started applying from this house. It just numbs you, you know, because you don't know. It sort of muddles your head because you can't understand it.
Now, the news of scammers has come as a shock to many living in Maribyrnong. The clean-up continues. Trucks and excavators are now shaving away at the piles of hard rubbish on the streets. The clean-up is exhausting residents here. Today marks day 6 since floodwater ravaged homes.
Australia's unemployment rate remains at near record lows, according to the latest job data out today. However, more Australians are struggling to make ends meet. Let's go live to Canberra and our politics reporter, Ashley Wick. Ash, good afternoon. These figures highlight an ongoing worker shortage.
Davina, the latest jobs figures for the month of September show unemployment has remained steady at 3.5%, with just 900 extra jobs created last month. An additional 9,000 people became unemployed. They are people now looking for work who previously weren't. Economists say that while the low unemployment rate is good news, the slowing jobs growth will be disappointing to some, but it's not surprising. That's because the Reserve Bank has been hiking interest rates to try to slow the economy and bring inflation under control.
From here on in, job growth starts to drop back into the slow lane after spectacular performance for quite some time.
Employment Minister Tony Burke says the focus now needs to be on wages growth.
Where there's significant global inflationary pressures on every household in Australia, today's figures in terms of jobs are to be welcomed. They're good figures, but they also tell the story as to why we need to get wages moving in Australia.
Labor will provide no solution. They promised they had a plan before the election, and I don't think there is going to be a plan delivered in the budget.
Treasurer Jim Chalmers is now putting the finishing touches on his first budget to be handed down next Tuesday. There has been speculation the government would ditch planned tax cuts for middle and high income earners, but the Prime Minister has ruled out breaking that election promise. Today we learned that those tax cuts are forecast to cost $250 billion over 10 years. That's $11 billion more than previously expected. Davina?
Ouch, and that's going to hurt. Okay, Ash, thank you. It's been described as a wake-up call for the nation. Medibank, the latest Australian organisation on a growing list of companies being hacked. But what does it mean for customers? Well, joining us this afternoon is tech expert Trevor Long. Trevor, thank you so much for your time. Out of all the hacks, this was the one that really scared me. What do we know about the information they've accessed in terms of being able to access personal medical records?
Davina, I think you're right, and I think a lot of people will be feeling that. The Optus hack of just a few weeks ago was very personal because it was my identity. It was things about me that could be used to pretend to be me. But this is even more personal because it's potentially medical conditions you've got, diagnosis you've had, scans you've had, places you've been for medical treatment. All those things linked to your name, your Medicare number, your email address, all those things, date of birth. It's a huge treasure trove of information for criminals and hackers and scammers, and that's why we now need to be on high alert, because even though Medibank is now the subject of a ransom demand, it's not likely they're going to pay that, and therefore there's no guarantee this information isn't going to be very quickly out on the internet.
Talk to us about the contact that they've had with the alleged hackers then.
Yeah, so Medibank have confirmed now via a statement to the ASX that they have heard from someone purporting to be the hacker and demanding a ransom. And critically, they've confirmed that they have seen data that the hacker has. And that 100 lines of data is essentially the hacker's way of saying, here, it's real. And Medibank has looked those and confirmed that it is Medibank customer data. They say it's from AHM or their international student coverage, but essentially it's real data.
Optus probably didn't surprise me in terms of a tech giant being hacked. Medibank does. What other organisations then do we think that should be safe with our information and with our private details that are now at risk?
Yeah, I think if we were to list the companies on size of customer base, that's what the hackers, this wouldn't have been easy. I'm not suggesting for a moment this was an easy hack, but hackers are not going to spend days, hours, weeks in their basement trying to get into a company with 10 people's details. If there's millions of customers, you're a target. Hundreds of thousands, you're a target. So the bigger the company, the bigger the target you are. And unfortunately for those businesses, this is a wake-up call that you need to spend properly on cybersecurity. There's going to be plenty of IT departments saying, I told you we needed to spend this, and there will be an investment. But also, Davina, those investments take time. Woolworths announced through their MyDeal hack this week, they acquired MyDeal some months ago, and they essentially accepted that there were some holes in the system. It's taken them a month, they didn't plug them. So this is not going to be solved quickly, and there will be more cyber attacks and breaches over the coming weeks and months.
It's a warning for us all. Trevor, thank you so much.